The presentation. So my presentation will be about, honestly saying, three buzzwords. So we have the Kubernetes, we have the real-time data analytics itself, and SQL data streaming that will become more and more popular. Moreover, it's great that before my presentation, there was a presentation about the Kafka Connect that we used in the one project, but because of the complexity of the whole platform and also the size of all the events that were processed by the Kafka Connect, we decided to move our pipeline directly to the Flink. So something about me. So I mainly work as the DevOps engineer and also a data engineer, and I'm mainly specialized in the public cloud. Here I can mention about the Google Cloud, AWS, and also some on-premises Hadoop and Kubernetes infrastructure. About the content, here you can see some major points that we'll discuss during today's presentation. So let's start with the introduction to the jungle, because here we talk about a lot of modern technologies that also are really complex in setting everything in the optimized way in the production. Surely, it's pretty easy to install the Kubernetes, especially when we have the public cloud and we can easily deploy, but it becomes more and more challenging when we want to achieve absolutely the best performance. When we talk about the Kubernetes, that is the orchestrator platform for containers, another really important thing is the operator. That is a method of deploying and managing the application. So we can create a dedicated operator for our application that will be specialized. So for example, we can talk about the Postgres operator that is created and maintained by Zalando. That is a great example of the operator that is designed for doing everything what we require from the database on the Kubernetes. And what is also pretty important in terms of the operators, that we have one setup for multiple environments. So we define everything as a code, and we define any available action directly within our Golang code. That is really good, but on the other hand, it requires some time and it can be challenging, especially nowadays when a lot of open source applications are changed really frequently, and there appear more and more features. The other thing that is important in terms of preparing something custom for Kubernetes is the definition of the custom resource definitions. That is a custom API that we install to our Kubernetes cluster, and it represents the desired state. And while the operator is responsible for doing everything work. Apache Flink is the open source stream processing framework, and in many blogs you can read about the comparisons between the Flink and Spark. But in fact, Spark is a great tool for batch processing, and the latest version of the Spark, so Spark 3. On the other hand, Flink requires, I would say, much more experience within and testing different configurations. And Flink is currently used by the companies like the Uber or Alibaba. So you can expect that it's used for really huge data platforms in which we process millions of events per second. One of the most important thing when we talk about the Flink from the administration and operation perspective is about the state of the Flink job. That is a consistent image of the execution state. So the Flink saves the information, what kind of data it processes, and from which moment it can restart processing the data. Here you can also see that the Flink is changing rapidly, and all of the committers, and also the Ververica, that is a company that is one of the major committer to the Flink, and in which you can find also offers of this great framework. They add a lot of new features. So one of the most important part that are coming to the Flink are mainly related to the SQL, so that you can create the Flink data platform on Kubernetes, for example, and you can provide your users only the interface in which they can write the SQL. It is really important because, as you may expect, a lot of data analysts, business analysts, know the Python and the SQL, but honestly, in most scenarios, they know SQL pretty well. So it's great that we can give them a unique opportunity to run a pretty complex job and also provide the platform for solving more complex business challenges and also doing everything in the real-time streaming manner in the simple way, because they can write the SQL. Surely, in fact, it requires some adding some configuration and testing different queries, but it's quite unique when we talk about current situation. Moreover, it can be easily connected with a lot of databases, and we can see that a lot of people commit directly to the Flink repository or create their own connectors. So it's great that you can connect the Flink with your Microsoft SQL Server or Oracle SQL, and you can simply process all the data within the Flink and then saves the results. About the perception, that is also really important in terms of choosing the right solution, because Flink solves a lot of challenges. But on the other hand, it's not the simplest tool to maintain, install, and mainly writing the jobs. Is that we need to remember that there are a lot of things about which we remember. So we're starting with the business logic that needs to be applied. But in fact, in reality, we need to remember about more components like the serving infrastructure that is also pretty important, also within the public cloud. About the comparison between the batch and stream. Well, in terms of the stream, we process continuously all the stuff. While in batch, we need to make a batch of some messages, like for example, 5, 10, or more. About some use cases in which the real-time data streaming is used. The first thing that is one of the most frequently used is recommendations. So, like in Alibaba e-commerce, you can see the advertisements. This recommendation is powered by the data analytics that is powered by Apache Flink, because the most important thing is the performance and the really low time of the result of this job. The another case which I think you may meet in your life is about the fraud detection. So in the banking sector, Flink is also a great tool to detect if there are any frauds. The another one is about monitoring the user activities, also about processing data from the IoT from the industrial IoT, and also managing all logistic stuff. About the use case, because use cases are always the greatest way to describe the solution, is the case that we provide directly with the KSL, that is the biggest telecom company in Kazakhstan, and that process a lot of events. So the most important part of this project was that we used a lot of data sources, then process them, and based on it, we ingest the business logic into the Flink job. And based on it, the Flink job triggers the following action, like, for example, sending the notification to the user, also providing the automatic SIM card activation. That is a really great use case. And also applying dealer motivation case. So when some defined rules were met, then it triggers some action. About the Apache Flink, because currently it supports some languages. So the most widely used is Java 8 or Java 11. There is also a possibility to use the Scala, also writing the job in the SQL. But in some cases, it would require also using the Java. And what is really important, in my opinion, it will cause that the Flink will become more and more popular, is that we can also write directly in the Python. So I suppose that it will be pretty similar situation like with the Apache Spark, which is widely used directly as the version with the Python. So I suppose that the data scientists will also move some of their pipelines from the Spark directly to the Flink. And as it's as the Flink is the framework that comes directly from the Hadoop ecosystem, we can install it also on the old our good friends, so the Yarn cluster. The another one is the Kubernetes, about which we'll talk, and the last one is about standalone. About the high availability, because it's the most difficult part of deploying the Flink, because Flink. Flink has the job manager that is responsible for managing the job status and also splitting all the tasks to each task manager. Task manager is the worker on which we process the data. And we need to be sure that the task manager has really great performance storage to which the task manager can save its state and from which we can easily restart our job. But and what is really important that it requires great performance. So, for example, in terms of the Kubernetes, it is recommended when we have a high load on our Kubernetes cluster that we would use the dedicated NVMe disk, because the RocksDB, that is the database used for storing the state of the Flink, requires great performance. So we can start with the simplest setup, but as the final solution, we would need to use the fast disks. So, for example, here we can talk about the local disk, but the next release of the Kubernetes, so the Kubernetes 1.21, will provide a great feature that can be combined with our Flink. And the next thing is about the storage. So that we need to have somewhere to store the save point of the whole job, and also we need to have defined to where our Flink job will save the results. Like, for example, in terms of the cloud, we can use the AWS S3 or any different database. Here you can see all available ways to install the Flink directly on the Kubernetes. So the first two are the operators, and in terms and the first one I use in the one project for the telco company, and it's a great operator, but in fact it still lacks some of the features. And as you can see directly in the GitHub repository, there are not so many commits, and the whole community around the open source solution is the crucial thing when we decide to use the one exact solution, not choosing the another one. But if you must use operator, because I also met some scenarios in which some engineers must use the operator, in that scenario, the Flink Kubernetes operator that was created directly by Lyft is a great tool. The another one is the Kubernetes operator for Apache Flink that you can find in the Google Cloud repository, but it's not maintained by Google. It's also quite interesting, but in fact, it's still a kind of early beta version. So here we come to the last two options. So the first one is the Vervérica platform that provides the whole graphical user interface, and in my opinion, it's the best solution to start your journey with the Flink, because you can easily install the Minikube on your computer, Docker desktop with enabled Kubernetes, and you can install the Vervérica platform, and then you can check what kind of features you can find directly in the Flink. And also what is really important, Vervérica platform is constantly developed by the oversoft of the Flink. So it means that they add quite frequently new features and fix some bugs that appear in any software. And in terms of the Vervérica platform, it is available in the free version as the community edition that has only one disadvantage, that is about that you need to store the metadata of this platform only in the SQLite that has some problems with logs, like always the same issues with the SQLite when the paid versions of the Vervérica platform has support for different databases like MySQL or the Postgres. And the last option that you can find is about using the native method, so deploying the Apache Flink on your by directly by yourself. So you build the image and you install everything as the deployment directly on your Kubernetes cluster. And why would we decide to use the Flink on the Kubernetes? In comparison to some Yarn cluster or using the standalone or using the virtual machines, it causes that the whole deployment process, managing the jobs, becomes pretty simple because you can create some scripts directly in your CI/CD tool like the GitLab, GitHub Actions, TeamCDN, and tools like this. Another one that you can pretty simple provide the monitoring of the job because Flink by default provides a wide range of the metrics exporter. In our case, we mainly use the Prometheus. And the last one is that we can simply provide the testing. So for example, we can make the A/B testing directly on the cluster and we can route the traffic based on some defined rules using the configuration change. So it's also great that it provides that the whole maintaining and managing the Flink job becomes pretty simple and you can be focused on writing the code and doing what is the most important. About the installation and configuration, here you can see the components that we use in most of our projects. So the most important part is the GitLab CI that we use in most. That verifies directly on the Kubernetes cluster, and while the managing of the configuration, like the config maps, the configuration of our deployments is verified directly by the Helm. And in terms of managing the secrets, in most situations we use the managed secrets managers directly within the cloud, or also using the HashiCorp vault. In terms of testing, Flink provides a quite useful feature that is also great for A/B testing. So imagine that that we want to test our new version of the application directly in the production. So we want to use the production data, but for example, we mustn't copy the data from the production to GDPR or any different security rules that are pretty important. And we can only deploy the new version of the job with the incubating mode directly to the production. And we only change the output. So we can, for example, choose the different bucket for it. While in terms of the A/B testing, it is also great that with the whole Kubernetes services, we can simplify the blue-green deployment. So and we want to verify. And about the whole deployment process, I would say it's pretty similar to any different CI/CD process that you can meet in the past. So the first thing is about writing the unit and integration test, about versioning images, deployment process that mainly depends on the chosen version of the Flink. And the last one is about monitoring. About Kubernetes aspects, I would say that the most important part is the storage, so the local storage that must be efficient for the task manager, and the different is about the storage in which we can store the save points. And the another important thing about processing events, like for example, reading the messages directly from the Kafka, from Pulsar, or any different data source and saving them somewhere, it is really important to verify the network performance. Because in some situations, the network can be bottleneck for our job. So it may be quite frustrating when we want to debug and provide the best performance, while in practice, the problem may be related only to the network issues. So in terms of the self-healing and auto-scaling, we can use also the tools that provides the whole Kubernetes ecosystem. And what is also pretty important that the Flink delivers its built-in restart feature. So also Flink is quite a robust solution, but surely we need to monitor the progress and also the job itself to be sure that everything is running as expected. But fortunately, if you use the Prometheus stack, in that scenario, you can find a lot of already prepared also dashboards in the Grafana. And when, but in terms of the updating the configuration of the job, in that scenario, we need to recreate our Flink job, and here we can talk about the job cluster and the session cluster. So the job cluster is great for the is especially great for the production jobs that is that are about being long running tasks. And in that scenario, we have a separate cluster for each individual job. The another option that is also a great when you deploy it locally only to test it is about creating the standalone Flink cluster on the Kubernetes. And it's also a great tool as being the cluster for running Flink SQL queries directly on it because it's shared resources between all the users who has access to the Flink. About the biggest challenges about the Flink, I would say that the most important part are all the time monitoring. It may be quite boring, but in fact, it's really important to monitor, especially JVM metrics, and having the tools for gathering and analyzing logs from Flink task managers and job managers, because it will simplify also the debugging. That may be really important. About the local setup, you need only to start with your Minikube or Docker desktop. You can also find the quick start directly on the Vervelica platform website. And for example, you can also start locally on the Docker or with using the Helm chart, you can start the Kafka cluster. I'll also use a datagen that is a custom data catalog to which we can create some dump data. What is a great thing about it is that we can simply create the window aggregation function with it, and we can also simply make fun with the Flink and also learn what kind of advantages it can deliver to our platform. And moreover, it provides really wide opportunities because, like for example, the Kafka Connect is a kind of limited solutions because it delivers everything out of the box. While in terms of the Flink, we can do absolutely everything. We can code everything and we can deploy it and then use, for example, a user-defined function within our SQL. About the observability, I think that I will not repeat everything about the monitoring. And about the logs analytics, that is also a great story from the production. So in our projects, we use mainly the Elasticsearch or Loki, that is a service created and all the time made in the, by the Grafana Labs. And Loki is a really lightweight framework that relies on the Promptail that reads the logs on each pod, and it pushes all the logs directly to the Loki. And in fact, being the lightweight solution means that Loki provides indexing only of the labels. So creating some more advanced queries is really tough. And in fact, Loki is not designed for it. But Loki is a great tool when you need to have a solution for monitoring all of the application logs that will be read by the developers, administrators, DevOps, or MLOps, or and anyone like this. About the alerts, in most situations, we can automate the tasks. So the alerts should be only sent when a human needs to verify the logs and then check what's happening with the Flink. About the first setup, when you finish your first setup on your local computer, you can easily set up the Kubernetes cluster in the public cloud, and then you can install with more resources. And it's also great that you can find easily some data generators, so you can start journey with the Flink, I would say, during the two evenings, and then you will learn about the most important basics. And it's really great that you can also simply test some operators that you can install with the, with these following five commands, and that's all. And I think, well, that it will be a high time to finish the presentation. So if you are interested also in working in the big data AI sector, and if you want to work directly with the Flink and anything what is related to this, you can also join us. So after this advertisement, I think that it's time for Q&A session. And you can also find me in the LinkedIn, and you can also drop me a message via LinkedIn or email. So I'm open to help you and also answer some questions if you have any related to the Flink, about using the Flink SQL and deploying everything to the Kubernetes.